Does your DaVinci Resolve playback look like this? Yeah, I don't like it either. Let's fix that. Hey everyone, Tim here, and today we're going to explore not only potential fixes for why your video playback and resolve is choppy, but also explain why they happen so that you can better optimize your workflow in the future. And with that, let's jump right in. The first and usually most effective fix for dealing with playback like this is generating proxy files. And I don't mean proxies in the form of smaller files necessarily, but proxies that are meant for making editing a lot faster. This refers to the actual video codec, and as you can see here, there are many different types, but we can generate the same type of proxy file for every single one of them. So we can go up to File, Project Settings, and then under Master Settings, we can scroll down, and then we have this Proxy Media Resolution and Proxy Media Format. If we drop down the media format, we get a number of options, and we're going to select ProRes 422 Proxy, as it uses the type of codec, which is an intra-frame type of codec, where every single frame is encoded individually, that we need for much faster editing while still having reasonably lower file sizes. And then with proxy media resolution, obviously the lower that this is, the smaller the file size, but the worse the quality. So I usually just stick with half or quarter, depending on what my original file sizes are. But we'll stick with half for now. And then if we go down to working folders, you'll see the proxy generation location. And that's just where your proxy media files will be placed. So we can go ahead and hit save. And then with all of our video clips highlighted, we can right click on any of them, go to proxy media, and then generate proxy media, and that will generate proxies for every single one of our clips. And once that's done, if we go up to this proxy handling tab and select prefer proxies, then it'll automatically link any proxy that we've created with that clip. But anytime you go to export, it'll automatically use the original source file. So proxies can be crucial for your workflow, especially if you're on a lower end system. The next common culprit for lag is effects, either in the form of video, audio, or external plugins. So let's go over the solutions one by one because there are different benefits to each. The first and most basic one is the timeline playback resolution. This will reduce the resolution in the preview window and require either half or quarter the processing needed for any visual effects. This doesn't affect performance on the video playback itself, just on effects processing. The second one is render cache. Now, you can specify what codec you want this cache to be generated in, similar to proxies. If you go back to your project settings and scroll down, you can see we have our render cache format here, and then also where you want those cache files to be generated. But what render cache will do is create preview files in the background so that it essentially pre-renders effects. And you can toggle how you want the render cache to behave, where you can turn on smart mode, which will auto detect any heavy effects that need caching, or you can select user mode and manually select what effects or clips to cache. And you can also manage your render cache or delete it if it's filling up your hard drive. And if you open Manage Render Cache, it'll show you all of your projects, and you can sort by render cache to see if there's any project that is taking up too much space. Now, what if we had some heavy audio effects in the mix? For example, if we had some voice isolation or dialogue separator, or if we had additional AI tools, or if we had other external plugins that we're using and that's causing some slowdowns as well. What we can do is we can actually go into the Fairlight page, and let's say that we have some heavy effects on a certain clip and it's causing it to not quite play back smoothly. We can actually right click on that audio clip, and we can either cache the audio, we can bounce the audio, which means it's generating a new wave file, like so, or we can export the audio file as its own different audio file entirely. But that's just something that can help your audio processing if needed. And then lastly, if we go back to the edit page, the last thing that we can do to any of our clips is we can render them in place, which will generate a new video file entirely. And this can be preferred if, let's say, I really want to just watch my Tim's Tasty Treats playback in all its glory. You should visit timstastytreats.com. Just kidding, it doesn't exist. We can right click on our effect or our clip, and we go to render in place, and then we can select whatever format we want. If it has an alpha channel, meaning a transparent background, you will want to choose something that has alpha channel, like Apple ProRes 4444. this one in this sense does, so we can switch it to this one. And then we can hit render. Then we specify where we want it to render to. We hit select folder, and that'll render it in place. And now we can watch our Tim's Tasty Treats logo play back in all its glory. So the next one we're going to talk about is the saver. Now this is Fusion related, but we are going to show this one really quick because it can be very helpful, especially for bigger Fusion comps. But for this simple example, let's say we had a magic mask here that we wanted to pre-render so we don't have to retrack it or worry about playback or caching later. So what we can do is we can actually add a saver in front of our magic mask. So we just shift space and then select our saver. And then we just select where we want to save this and we give it a name. And essentially what the saver will do is it'll create an image sequence of whatever is going into it. So if we put something like a transform or anything else after the saver, this will not actually go into the saver. This is what's happening after. So the way that we actually render this out is we go up to Fusion and then select render all savers, and that'll render out the entire saver. And then once that's done, we can add what's called a loader node. So we'll shift space again and type in loader, and then we select any of the EXR files that the saver generated, select open. And now if we plug the loader in, now we have a pre-rendered comp. Now, if you're on a Mac, you can skip this one, but we want to make sure that we're using the correct GPU drivers for our system. A GPU driver is basically how your graphics card and operating system communicate with each other to actually display images on your screen, and there are typically different ones for gaming and content creation. For example, if you have an NVIDIA card, you can open the NVIDIA app, go to Drivers, and bring down this tab and select the Studio driver. Then you can run through the normal installation process from there. And if you have an AMD GPU, they used to have a Pro Edition driver several years ago for their main consumer cards, but currently seems to only be available to their Radeon Pro workstation cards, so check your specific card for more details. And speaking of checking stuff, another good thing to check is your RAM speed, because Resolve loves its memory. Once again, this is Windows only, but we'll open Task Manager and go to the Performance tab. With my RAM specifically, I should be seeing 3200 MHz, but I'm only getting the default speeds of 2133. This is also for DDR4 RAM. For DDR5, the default is 4800. To fix this, we actually need to go into our BIOS by restarting our computer and pressing delete until it shows up. And every BIOS is going to look very different, but you want to look for something called XMP profile, DOCP, or Expo, depending on your system. And we want to select that to make sure we're getting the full performance from our RAM. And once I select that and reboot, now if we pull up Task Manager again, I'm getting my full 3200 MHz speeds. Now inside of Resolve, we want to double check and make sure that Resolve is using all of our resources properly. So if we go up to DaVinci Resolve and Preferences, and then Memory and GPU, we can make sure that Resolve is using as much of your RAM as possible, unless you need RAM for other applications. And then we want to uncheck the auto boxes so we can manually select what Resolve uses. And this Neural Engine box will only show if you have Resolve Studio and the GPU that supports it. On this drop-down box, this will all depend on what GPU you have, but generally, if you're on NVIDIA, you'll want this to be set to CUDA. And on a Mac, Metal is typically the best option, but if you don't have these options, then you'll likely just have OpenCL. Here in our decode options, we can ensure that hardware acceleration is enabled. Again, this will look different depending on your system. And then we can go to the User tab, Playback Settings, and switch performance mode to manual so that we can ensure that Resolve doesn't automatically turn off your optimization, especially for lower end systems. Now, the next one we're going to talk about are hard drives. Now, there's two main categories when it comes to hard drives. There's hard disk drives and solid state drives, and there's obviously significant variance inside of those two that can cause dramatic differences in speed, but we're going to focus on the main key differences between the two. Hard disk drives, while usually being significantly cheaper, are also much more physically limited in their read and write speeds, which basically means how fast you can open a file or transfer files to and from it. And they also tend to be a little bit slower if you're first trying to access them. Solid state drives, or SSDs, along with being significantly faster, are also typically much more stable, they last a lot longer, and they are usually more expensive. But all in all, you pretty much always want to be working off of an SSD if possible, and use a hard disk drive for long-term storage. Now, the next thing we're going to check in your project is if you're using multiple drives inside of the same project. And to show you what I mean by that, we can go to the media page to make this easier to see. Sometimes you might have files in multiple places or simply duplicate files, and if Resolve is trying to read from multiple sources, especially if they're different speeds, that can cause slowdowns. So if possible, we want everything to be in one location. So if we can check this by using the File Path tab, which you can right-click and enable here if it isn't enabled already, and then we can highlight all of our bins on the side, and we can sort by file path, because the first part of the location it will give us is the drive letter. So when we sort by this, we can see that all my files here on my D drive, except for a few files down here, which are actually connected to my G drive, which is not where I want them. Thankfully, I know that they're actually located on my D drive as well. So I can highlight them, right click, go to clip operations, relink them, navigate to the folder they're in, and now everything is linked to the correct drive. And hopefully this video helped you fix any of these issues that you were having, or at the very least made it run a little bit better with the setup that you had. Leave a comment down below if you experience issues like this, what video you want to see in the future, or what your favorite camera brand is and why it's Fujifilm.